Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Craig Marsh. I'm the Provost Chancellor and Head of the College of Business, if I've not had a chance to meet you so far, and I hope I'll do something about that by the end of the evening if I haven't. So a very warm welcome to all of our internal and especially our external guests to this evening. It is fabulous to have so many people here for what is such an important event, both for the College of Business and for the University of Lincoln. For those of you who haven't been here before, welcome to the Engine Shed. It is a, I'm told by my teenage kids, a very known, well-known venue for pop concerts. It is a very important part of the university as well. And as you know, it used to be a railway engine shed, and it's right at the heart of our university and at the heart of our student union. So it's a really appropriate place to be holding this event. Now, my job right now is really just to give you a very warm welcome. Hope that you all enjoy the evening. I hope that you also get something out of the evening, apart from my keynote, that is, but everybody else, I'm sure, will give you stuff that's really interesting and informative. And to encourage you to network, to share notes, compare notes with our colleagues who are from the university, and hopefully by the end of the evening, leave your business cards such that we can follow up with you and talk about potential future business. So that's my plug for the evening. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce a member of the team, Jane Owen Jones, who is going to act as compere for the evening and keep us all to time, Jane. Is that right? That's what you said.
I'm going to try.
Good luck with that.
Everyone. Well, it's still strictly afternoon, otherwise we'd be on gin and tonics by now, but what I'd like to do as a quick start is maybe introduce yourself to the people on the table. Just a few minutes, you may have done that, but if you haven't, just have a quick conversation amongst each other about who you are, what you're doing here, etc. I'll time you out in about 3 minutes' time. Okay. Have you all found out the nicknames of the people around your table? Had a chance to find out who's sitting there. I'm sort of the MC for the next few hours, so sadly I don't do jokes, so I'm sorry about that. But anyway, just to tell you a few things that are going to be occurring as we go through the next few hours. First of all, points of safety. You can actually see the exit points here. There's two fire exits here, there's one at the back, and actually the muster point is a square in the middle of the university. We have some very exciting nightclub-type toilets here, the likes of which I've not been in for several years, but they're great fun, which are all just down there on the right, through the double doors, and it's so dark, it depends which one you find yourself in, whether you're in the boys or the girls, but I'm sure you'll have a good time trying to find out. In terms of what you have on the table, you have a takeaway there with information about the business school, plus the sort of services that we have spent a lot of time trying to put together over the last sort of 6 or 9 months, in fact, that you might appreciate and might interest you. Now, there is a session later on that talks about that very briefly, but that really is, you know, the sort of point for you to take away, read through and so on. It's a good sort of start point for any contact with the business school in the future. In terms of my role, I will try and actually keep the speakers to time, and at the end of each session there will be some time for asking questions. So, and I'll try and control that so we make sure that everyone's got a fair chance for that. I'm going to admit now you haven't got time for a break throughout this, because you know what happens in large audiences. If you have a break, we'll never get you back in here again. So realistically, if you would like to use the facilities, please feel free to do so when you want to. But of course, at the end of the evening, I'm trying to encourage you now, at about 6:30, 6:45, there will be the sort of popping of corks and a few canapes coming out to sort of, you know, make sure that you've got something to keep you going on your way home. And that is a good chance to network with everybody in the room, as Craig has already mentioned, both with sort of university staff, with academics, and also with other people in the room. So we intend to make sure that you've got at least half an hour of that at the end of the session. Realistically, we might run on until 7:30. So I'm just sort of saying that now, but we will have a drop dead time finish in terms of presentations and questions at 6:45. So that will be when we'll actually sort of get the refreshments out. So I just want to talk about transformational leadership, actually. This is a very simple slide, but that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. Now, this is a good time to talk about it, because actually with the election last week, I'm sure some of you were actually sitting there wondering about the leadership capability of the politicians in this country. And who might you might describe as the transformational leader out of all of the mainstream leaders? If I had time, I'd come around and get a poll from who you thought. But I have to say, regardless of, you know, your political leanings, clearly the most transformational leader, under my definition, that occurred over the general election was Jeremy Corbyn. Why was he transformational? Because if you actually look at some of the definitions as transformational, it's around about vision, and it's around about getting people to follow you. And actually, boy, did he manage to do that, whether you like him or not. But before we talk about that, I just want to explore leadership for a second, because if you can tell from this graph, and I have stolen this particular slide from my colleague, Mr. Marsh, if we have a look at the number of books dedicated to leadership on Amazon, and this was yesterday's number, 179,721. Okay, 180,000 books on leadership. What are we meant to make out of that? Does this tell us that it's not possible for any of us to really get to be that great leader or that transformational leader because there's so many different interpretations of it? I mean, actually, if you actually read them all at the rate of one per day, it would definitely take you over 250 years to read them. So is this helpful or not? So the leadership debate goes on in terms of what we actually learn from that. We've got two great experts tonight to give you some insights into transformational leadership, bearing in mind that really you haven't got time to read all those books on Amazon. We've got Jase Corker, who's Jase Corker, who is from Mission Excellence. And Mission Excellence are an organisation that's composed of ex-Red Arrows pilots. Jase himself was actually Red One for some time. He's gone into work in the MOD before he went into Mission Excellence. He has a massive history in terms of looking at leadership, his insights into leadership, and what he can bring to bear this evening. And then we've got Dr. Craig Marsh, introduced as the Pro Vice Chancellor. He's worked in a variety of different academic institutions. Before that, he worked in private sector business, commercial business, various HR roles. So both of them have a different angle to bring in terms of leadership. Both of them have different insights in terms of leadership and transformational leadership. I mean, interestingly enough, from my own perspective, I particularly like a definition, because it's simple, that was put together by a professor in Chicago called Ulrich. And he talked about transformational leadership in pursuit of competitive advantage. And I sort of like that, because it's actually talking about, effectively, you know, what are we trying to do with transformational leadership? It needs to be in pursuit of something. And he describes a transformational leader as somebody who's a visionary, but spends their time scanning the external environment. So actually they can bring all the issues to bear, and actually the opportunities to bear, into their organisations, to actually see what that can do for the organisation and in pursuit of something. So, moving forward, this is just a brief of the sort of timeline that we've got. Going to move on to actually introduce Jase in a second. After that, some questions. We'll actually go to Dr. Marsh, and then we're going to have a sort of 15-minute summary of the services that the university can provide you and help you with in terms of your organisations. And then we're moving on to the drinks and canapes. So it should be a fantastic evening. I hope you enjoy it. Please make notes as you go through. There is a chance to ask questions. And I'll get a chance to meet you afterwards over a glass of bubbly. So, Jase.
Jane, thank you very much. Let me just start off with a question, if I may. How many of you, when you were... you know, 5 or 6 years old, used to run around the playground or the park with your arms out like this, pretending to be fighter pilot or pilot of some sorts? Oh, come on. Quite a few. Hands up. How many of you still did that when you were 18 years old? How did you get away with it? I mean, the only way that I could really get away with that kind of behaviour was by joining the Royal Air Force. My mum said, go and get a job, and I ended up doing stuff like this.
speaker today, Dr. Craig Marsh, Pro Vice Chancellor of the Business School. He's going to be taking a slightly different view on transformational leadership to Jace, but I hope you can actually start to pull the pieces together to start to get a view on this. So I'm going to hand over now to Craig, who will introduce himself.
Yep, thanks very much, Jane. Is that working okay? Can you hear me at the back? Is that all right? Good. So I'm sure you're all listening very carefully to Jace. While I was listening to it, I'm thinking, oh my God, I've got to follow that. Now, this is why I'm a bit of an idiot, because I'm actually nominally in charge of this. And that's the second time in a few months I've had to follow that presentation. So I should have insisted on him talking about underwater basket weaving or something so I could compete with it. Anyway, I am going to have to follow that. And there's a couple of, it's a sort of double jeopardy thing, actually, when you're talking about leadership. When you've got most of your team in the room, you're at risk of something which I'm sure will become known as the Theresa May effect, where you know you've got basing an election campaign on the catchphrase "strong and stable leadership," and then look what happened to her. You know, I'm thinking they're looking at me thinking leadership. Yeah, what do you know about it? So that's the first issue I've got. The second issue, actually, and Jane and Jason alluded to it. Both the word transformation and the word leadership are what, as academics like to know, contested terms. So despite those 120,000 books written about leadership, nobody's still that clear on exactly what we mean by it. So what I thought I'd do is give a personal view on both of those terms, on the term transformation. So I think it'd be good to dig into a little bit about what we actually mean by transformation, and then come back onto to leadership, just from my own experience, and from my own research, and then try and stitch the two together a little bit, just to see if there's any useful conclusions we can draw about the challenges that many of you have faced in your organisations when it comes to dealing with transformation. I also tried to find some nice pictures to show, as you'll see in a second. It's a little bit different, but as I was preparing this talk, it occurred to me that it was 30 years ago this week that I was doing my undergrad finals. In classics, as it happened. So as I was thinking about transformations that I'd experienced in my past, I was thinking about classics. And you'll see what I mean in a second. So it's a chance to reminisce a bit. And it's also a chance to deal with ancient history in two terms, like 30 years ago, and have a look at some. Now, I'm sure you'll all recognize this chap. This is Ramesses II. Statue of Luxor, there are plenty, there's about four or five colossal statues of Ramesses around. A classic of Egyptian monumental sculpture. This one dating from around 1250 BC. But it conforms to a type of art that remained essentially unchanged for about 3,000 years, which is why it's so instantaneously recognizable as an Egyptian statue. For all of this period, sculpture conformed to some pretty precise and rigid principles of design. So the dramatic in scale and impact, this is about 6 or 7 meters high, and they made no effort to appear lifelike. But there remained a stylized representation of the human form. Now, something interesting happened in around 750 BC. The Greek state of Athens, city-states, changed its rules such that they suddenly opened up to the world and started trading with Egypt. Now, at the time, the Greeks were producing statues like this. Now, I'm sure this was meant to be fierce, but this little cutie, which is a statue of a warrior, probably looked a bit more fierce when he had his spear in his hand. This is basically what the sum total of Greek statuettes was at this time, about 750 BC. Now, they were as astounded as everybody else when they went to Egypt and started looking at that stuff. Now, what's really interesting, I think, for me anyway, is what happened next. By about 520 BC, so about 200 years later, 250 years later, they were producing this. Now, bear in mind, the Egyptians have been doing the same stuff for 3,000 years with very little change. Now, this is a kouros, and for those of you who may be a little bit uncomfortable with the full majesty of the naked male form, I've cut him off at the hips, but you can get the general idea. Now, you can still see bits of the Egyptian in this, all right? So he's not particularly lifelike. He's got that very odd smile for a start, and the hair looks a bit Egyptian. But what you're getting already within a couple of hundred years is the Greeks in Athens starting to produce something that's having a real shot at representing the human form in a lifelike way. Now that smile is quite interesting because this is actually a funerary object. These kuroi were designed as funerary statues. So why is he smiling? Well, the reason why he's smiling is because that's the best way they knew at the time of representing the face in a lifelike way. That was the only way they could do it. Now, watch this. One generation. This is the Critias boy. So within 30 years, they've taken the sculpture from what you see on the left to what you see on the right. And suddenly, the man emerges from the stone. What you have is lifelike hair. The smile has gone. The head turns. The body relaxes. The human form is starting to be captured for the very first time in civilization in a lifelike way. And of course, what led from this is all of the wonders of classical civilization, the Parthenon, that we know and love when we visit it. Now, for me, this is an unbelievable transformation in the history of art. And the question that really fascinates me is, what was it? What was happening in the city-state of Athens around about 500 BC that led them to take something that they'd seen that had been saved for 3,000 years and within 250 years produce for the very first time something that is quite lifelike? Before answering that question, because I will try and answer it, let me show you another example. So skip forward about 19 centuries, and this is the kind of artwork that was kicking around Europe in the 13th century, 14th century. This is from a depiction of Constantine from a chapel in Rome. It doesn't really matter which one. It's beautiful in its own right. But again, very stylistic, no sense of proportion, conforming to a particular pattern or design that was entirely regulated by the church. Very, very standardized. Now, for me, what's really interesting about the Renaissance is the very early stages of Renaissance. Okay, so you can all marvel at the wonders of the late Renaissance, the high Renaissance of Michelangelo, Da Vinci, Botticelli. But there was a moment when someone, for the very first time, turned something like that into that. And it happened more or less within the lifetime of one individual. And this is a bad boy, and I call him a bad boy because that's what his nickname was, Masaccio. It's kind of, you know, a little ruffian or something. This is Masaccio, died at the age of 28 in mysterious circumstances in Rome. And this comes from the Brancacci Chapel in Florence. Now, I'm sure many of you have been to Florence. If you've not been to the Brancacci Chapel, take a diversion. So it's on the south bank of the Arno, and it was known as the birthplace of Renaissance art in Florence. And you can see what he's done. He's got perspective, he's got color, he's got lifelike people in there. And actually, when you look really closely, I'm just going to wander over for a second. That's Masaccio in his own picture, looking straight at you. Now, what's happening here is something really interesting, I think. So what is it? What has led from that to that in the space of about 30 years or so? So here we've got a couple of guys who are responsible for that. The bottom one is Masaccio, the one I've just showed you. Now, perhaps I should emphasize at this point that I'm not going to be teaching you to sculpt like Critias or paint like Masaccio. That happens over in the College of Arts, so they've got some great courses on that if you're interested. But one advantage of choosing examples of transformation in the history of art is that it's relatively easy to see in hindsight, right? You pick the moment and you can see that transformation happening almost overnight in historical terms. So the question I just asked a few minutes ago, what is going on in those societies, in those city-states, that led to that kind of transformation at that time? Now, bear in mind that what we're talking about here are two city-states. Now, in neither of these cases, the nation wasn't born as a concept at this point. So Athens was a city, something reaching 30,000 at that time. Florence, after the Black Death, was around 40,000. So we're talking about relatively small populations, no bigger than some of our biggest organisations or company. Now, a common theme, I've got to put some words up here on the slide. So a common theme in both of these cases was trade. So I've mentioned trading with Egypt. So what was going on here is an opening up of trade. So that's things, so new ideas and wealth being commissioned into the society. Wealth being commissioned as in people commissioning the art. So there's a lot of wealth going on in there. So that's a really important part of it, and opening up to new ideas and creativity. Technology played an important role. So in Athens, they had access to the marble quarries and the hills around Attica. In the case of Florence, Masaccio actually was originally a designer of manuscripts. He painted manuscripts, and he took a bit of technique from manuscripts and illustration, all the line that he used to draw around it, and put it around his human figures to give them a bit of depth. And it's the first time anybody had done that. So there's a technology going on there. I've hinted at another one, the workshop. So one of the things that was really key about Florence at this time is a workshop that combined a number of different masters from different places and had them generate new stuff. There's so much art being produced that they had to do it in a workshop. It was generally one master that oversaw it. Now, I think then there is a secret source which is really critical for this period of transformation. And I put that at the top. Now, democratization, incredibly generic word. So in Athens, the chap at the top there, Pericles, was starting to generate structures and a society that was putting the individual first and putting free choice and agency much higher up in terms of the society. And a couple of people, Pericles being one of them, and a couple of guys in Florence had these really big ideas. And you can see that on the right-hand side. They had this idea about freeing up people to take full part in the life of their state. And if you just think back at the pictures, the people are in them. This is the dawn, in both cases, of the rediscovery of the individual in society. And I think this is absolutely fundamental to the process of effective transformation. And it's something I'll come back to in a little bit later. Now, the other thing that's going on, of course, is they had this, what you might call, big idea. Now, Jace has already referred to the vision. Risk becoming a bit of a cliche, but just listen to a couple of them. In Athens, Pericles said, and this is a quote from a funeral oration, "If we look to the laws, they afford equal justice to all in their private differences. Class consideration is not allowed to interfere with merit, nor again does poverty bar the way. If a man is able to serve the state, he is not hindered by the obscurity of his condition. The freedom which we enjoy in our government extends also to our ordinary life." 15 centuries later, one of the fathers of the early Renaissance, Bruni, in 1428, the year that Masaccio died, says, "Equal liberty exists for all. The hope of winning public honours and ascending is the same for all. This, then, is true liberty, this equality in a commonwealth, to enjoy equality among citizens before the law and participation in public office. It is marvellous to see how powerful this access to public office is once it's offered to free people. It proves to be in awakening the talents of its citizens. Since such hope and opportunity are held in our commonwealth, we need not be surprised that talent and industry distinguish themselves to the highest degree." These were the sorts of big ideas that they were developing in these two city-states at the time, and this is really fundamental transformation. Now, the reason why I scattered these around is if you start, so I started playing academic, okay, playing around with models. So you started playing with a model that may explain some of this, and I'll come back to this in a second. So, two dimensions, social, political, and structure process on one side, internal orientation and external orientation on the other side. What you've got are four things, essentially, that are going on that are driving transformation. And I would argue that any leader confronted with the transformation that we have to face with has to deal with these four things. There's the big idea, there's a community engagement model, your external community, there's an organisation, i.e. your internal organisation, for innovation and value creation, and then there's innovation in leadership itself. Now, I'd like you just to keep those in mind a little bit when I come on to talk a little bit more modern about what's going on in terms of transformation in our modern life. But bear in mind, one thing is speed. Okay, so in classical Athens, 5th century BC, the speed of that transformation was around 300 years. In Florence, it was 30 years. So now let's have a look at what the speed of transformation is these days. You have all heard and are all familiar with Moore's Law, and the speed of transformation on an exponential scale of computing power is what is driving both the second industrial revolution, which we're right in the middle of, but also just the pace at which stuff is happening. And this guy, Kurzweil, did something quite interesting. So Moore was around in the 1960s. What he did was extend it back 100 years and said, Moore's Law applies to the last four paradigms of technology and computing. And that's basically what this chart is saying. So on a very strong, a very stable, and an exponential change curve. And this is kind of what's driving. It is beyond doubt that this is the situation we're in. So let's take one particular sort of semi-historical example of this. Now, This is another exponential curve, so it's technology again. And what it's showing is the three graphs on it, essentially. I'll come to it in a second. So you've got the red graph, the red line at the bottom on the graph. This is mobile phone technology in the 1980s and 1990s. Okay. Now, if mobile phone technology had expanded its capability linearly, it would have followed, over 10 years, that red line, nice and steady growth at about 8 or 9% a year. What actually happened was the yellow line. Okay, and you can see the dates on there. So massive exponential growth in the capability of phones. Now, what I find quite interesting about this chart, and that's why I couldn't resist quoting Michael Gove on here, is the orange lines that disappear out to the right. Because what those are the predictions of the market experts in the growths of mobile phone capability in each of those years. They got it quite badly wrong. They got it at 16%, 14%, 12%, and 10% when it was already growing at over 100% a year and growing exponentially. How on earth could they get it so wrong? Well, I think one of the lessons for this, actually, when we're looking at transformation that's all around us, is that if you look at the first part of the graph, transformation on an exponential curve is actually pretty difficult to spot. This kind of stuff is growing. If you just think about it in some sort of number format, you know, it's kind of 0.05 and then 0.1. And then 0.2, and then 0.4, and then 0.8. And who's going to spot that? But then it starts to get 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. So when it's at the 0.2 and 0.4 level, it's pretty difficult to spot. Now, that's one thing that's going on. The other thing that's going on here is that we are fundamentally not designed as humans to spot nonlinear growth. Because linear growth explains kind of history. That's how we're wired. It's safe, it's stable, and we think that what's happened in the past is a great way of predicting what's going on in the future. These days, it is absolutely not. So there's something going on here which is about both exponential, about speed, and about our difficulty to predict it. So let me just give you another example of this, which is totally astonishing as far as I'm concerned. Now this is, I think, probably also a graph that you might have seen, right? So this is growth in internet connections. So it was a prediction by Ericsson in 2010. And what they were saying is connections between places on the internet, that's the orange line, is going to grow at that rate. Oh, okay, so it's not too bad. Connections between people is going to start growing pretty exponentially. Connections between things, the internet of things, is going to grow enormously rapidly, and that is the green line. So they knew all about this stuff about exponential curves. They predicted 50 billion, this is in 2010, by 2020, 50 billion devices connected by 2020, 10 years on. Were they right? No, they weren't. Last year, they adjusted their prediction for 2020 to 500 billion. So they kind of got it a bit wrong again, to the order of about 10 times. And who knows whether their latest prediction is right or not. So to conclude, I've just got a couple of things. So what's going on these days? The speed of transformation. And if you think about those classical examples, you can just see how things have really sped up over recent years, and now we know things are moving at right light speed. The second thing is that we're not particularly good at picking up these transformations. And so one way of thinking about this is this quote that I like from Douglas Adams, and you can read it. You know, if you're 0 to 15, anything in the world is just normal and it's just the way the world works. Anything that's invented between the age of 15 and 35 is new and exciting and revolutionary, and you can probably get a career in it. Anything invented after you're 35 is against the natural order of things. And I'm 52 and I'm thinking, my God, am I a dinosaur? But there is also, I think, a bit of an age thing. We find it really difficult to spot things, particularly when we haven't invented them. And I think that's an issue for leadership that I'll come back to. Now, the third thing, which you just mentioned, is a rapid shift, and this is the one I'd just like to spend a minute on, is a rapid shift from scarcity to abundance on that exponential curve. A rapid shift. What do I mean by scarcity to abundance? Well, you just think about a couple of examples. I'm probably not going to share one with you here, actually. You all recognize this Google car. That thing on the top is called LIDAR, for those who aren't technology-minded like me. What it is the little radar thing that stops it from banging into stuff. Light detection and ranging. 2012, cost $70,000. Last year, cost $50. This year, cost $50. Predicted 2020, $10. Now you can see that even just through the plummeting cost of something, that means that bit of kit is going to become far more abundant than it was before. So one of the consequences of these sorts of transformations is suddenly spotting something which was rare expensive and difficult to get hold of, and it's suddenly becoming cheap and readily available. Now, as leaders of transformations, I think you've got to be onto this. You really have. So, think Airbnb. Airbnb, they don't have to build any hotels, all right? So they're competing against Hyatt. Hyatt wants to add a room to their inventory, they've got to build a hotel to do it. Costs quite a bit of money. Airbnb costs them, well, virtually nothing to do it. This is the move from scarcity to abundance. Incidentally, for my colleagues particularly, the world of education is no different. 10 years ago, an academic could reach an audience of typically 200 students with one of his lectures, depending on the size of the lecture theatre, of course. And in most cases, there's a significant cost to the student to be able to sit in that lecture theatre. Maybe it still is. Now, the same teacher can reach an audience of 200,000 with that lecture, maybe even 2 million, and the students don't have to pay anything for it, and they can access it wherever they are on their mobile phones. That's an example of how our industry is affecting it. What it's doing is it's turning on its head the traditional models both of organisation and of value creation, including our own, the university, something we have to be very much aware of. So if, like me, you find these examples of transformation pretty uncomfortable, let's talk about it in terms of leadership. I think for far too long, we have endured the cult of the transformational leader, defined for me, in my opinion, as somebody who possesses extraordinary, almost superhero traits of charisma, inspiration, visioning, creativity, and somebody who's in control in every meaning of the word. And apologies for any colleagues here, and I have some very dear friends who are American. This is a discourse that has been created, generated, and marketed by our colleagues across the pond in the US. That type of leadership is deeply ingrained in US history. Now, but if you've been onto anything that I've been talking about in terms of the history of transformation, I think, apart from a couple of superheroes, and there may be some here, as mere mortals, we're not actually all that well equipped for dealing with the transformation that we speak of seeing it. And if we're still interested in transforming, then the process of democratization is absolutely central to our ability to lead transformation. And I don't just mean living in a democratic society. It's looking very closely at how democratic our organizations are, how free they are for people themselves to transform. About 15 years ago, I got very interested in organizations that were doing some really different and really radical things, turning the HR policy book on its head, or perhaps more accurately, ripping it up. And when I came across, and I'm sure a few of you have heard of this guy, Ricardo Semler. He was running his family business in Brazil, in Sao Paulo, called Semco. And Semco, by the way, wasn't an internet company, wasn't a high-tech company. These guys made cement mixers, if memory serves. And because of an existential crisis, he basically turned his company completely on its head. And he published this book about what he did called Maverick. It came out in about 1990. It takes you about an hour to read. It is brilliant. And it was a bestseller at the time. In fact, he ended up making an academic career out of it, which you certainly think about it. But became a full-time academic, promoting ideas on social democracy. Company's still there. This is Semco as it is today. Joint venture partner for anybody who wants to work in Brazil. I can recommend it. And what he did, he started to allow his own employees to make decisions about absolutely anything. It was partly down to his health, actually, because he realized that the cost on him, the burden of running this company, was taking its toll on his health. He had a couple of health crises. So he said, all right, I can't be doing with this, because it's going to kill me. So his next book was called The 7-Day Weekend, which kind of gives you a bit of an indication about his philosophy about leadership. His philosophy essentially was to create a structure that was democratic and then nothing himself. And that's what he did. He spent a couple of years by his swimming pool in his house in Sao Paulo. Company went strength to strength. Employees made investment decisions. There was absolutely nothing they were involved. They could fire their own bosses. Personally, I wouldn't recommend that, guys, but there was a lot of really weird stuff going on there. And he used to get challenged all the time about this. And he said, well, nevertheless, it kind of works, right? It's here. I'm growing from success to success. I mean, I think the numbers are quite extraordinary. It turned from a 2 million company into a 200 million company in really no time at all. Now, I'm not advocating, by the way, that we stop work altogether, because I think that would be pretty silly. But the style of leadership, by the way, I don't think it's about us as leaders. I think it's about the people that we're leading. Now, that sounds a bit of a cliche. What I mean by that is that we've got to work hard to create the structures. Think really hard about those. Create the structures that allow our people to do the transformation for us. Because we're not going to spot those trends, but I guarantee that there's some 18-year-olds or 21-year-olds in your teams who will do. So you've got to free them up to be able to spot them, create with them, and do something different with them that's maybe going to transform your company. Now, one of the things that's going on here, of course, is everything is now open. So you'll see in a second, I've got some examples here. I mentioned Airbnb before. There are no boundaries around stuff anymore. You've got crowdsourcing going on, you have communities building up, and you've got companies that are exploiting these transformational trends. So here, have a look at a couple of them and see what sorts of stuff these guys do. This is quirky, okay? It's, you see the top, big idea, makes invention accessible. It's a community, it's a platform. They've reduced the time to product development from an average of 300 days to 29 days. These guys, Local Motors, we're not here to build cars, we're here to reinvent them. Reduce the typical cost of developing a new car from $3 billion to $3 million. These guys, Tangerine, probably never heard of them, it's a Canadian bank. What they've done is they're through their platform, see that forward thinking is their motto, 7 times more customers per employee and 4 times more deposits per customer than the average for the banking sector. The people who are around you, the people who work with you in partnerships or in joint ventures in your extended global, they're the ones who need to come together to provide the solutions for the next stage of your transformational journey. In these companies, the community is everything. All you're doing is setting the structure and the purpose and letting them have a go at it. What they're doing essentially in economic terms is they're dropping the cost of supply dramatically. Google does not have to pay you, you don't have to pay Google to search on its search engine. What it gets is its revenue from marketing, as we've been hearing a lot about recently. The community provides the supply, and they exist outside the boundaries of any traditional models of organization that most of us, I suspect, still work in. Now, these transformations do, I think, affect how we lead. When you think about it a bit more, the kind of positions that probably certainly put me in a leadership position, possibly you, those technical skills, they're not relevant anymore. They're often, you know, you get to the head of an SME, you've been developing your own products and services, you're the expert, maybe been your own inspiration, your own creativity that got you there, you know best, but I don't think you necessarily know how to take the risk of allowing others to get their hands on your baby. So there's probably a moment, I mean, just think about how many CEOs have been displaced when they've created a fabulous company and they've been displaced because they've kind of really lost control of the plot. Most recent one being the CEO of Uber, actually, this week. I don't think this is about you as leaders. Sorry to say that. I think it's about what you're doing in your environment. Now, I think what maybe is another way of putting it is that your development and your leadership is a necessary condition for all this, but it's not a sufficient condition. And I think this brings me, I think, to the final part of my presentation we'd like to know. So coming back to that that wonderful model that I showed you earlier, I think your development as a leader has to go hand in hand with the development of your organization and your context. So that's one of the reasons why at LIBS we have this idea that the process of action learning has to be at the core of what we work with with our partners. It's not just you, it's about your teams, it's about your partners, it's about your business model, it's about your vision as a leader, it's about your big idea, and we work with a particular challenge that you're faced with and help you to develop that through consulting interventions, through training, through executive intervention, through facilitation to create value by working with you on the means to deliver your challenge, to create new value for you. Your style, your behavior is only several, they're important, but they're only one of several elements in this process. So, coming back to this model, let's have a look at a couple of these just to summarize some of the things that I've seen going on and I've just shown you from some of these organizations. So here are some of the big ideas. It takes quite a while to come up with these sometimes. So here's one I'm sure you'll recognize, organizing the world's information. Yes, it's Google. Make invention accessible, I think we just saw that. Positively impact 1 billion people. So part of what leaders seem to be doing is setting this context, really engaging people with this massive idea, this big idea. Then what they seem to be doing, on the bottom right here, is engaging with their external community in totally different ways. So you've got the community building the product, you've got innovating it, you've got crowdsourcing going on, and most of all, what's that going on economically, is it's wiping out your cost of supply. So suddenly your market cap goes through the roof. at least your marginal cost of supply goes through the roof. Third thing, organising. Radical, democratic, innovation, organisation structures. Be a platform. If you could be a platform, it looks like a pretty good recipe for success. Take a look also at a Skunk Works. Where in your organisation are people, and Jace mentioned this, where are they totally free, completely free, all rules gone, to experiment, to think, to generate, to look at trends, come up with something new. Skunk Works on there. And then finally, that bit about leadership and governance. Diversification is absolutely critical. We all know that 18-year-olds are pretty inventive, pretty diverse. Get some of them in there. Do you have them in your teams? The idea of distributed leadership, and again, you're not the only one here, right? It's how your leaders, your other leaders, are helping others to transform as well. And this idea of action learning, making sure that everybody is learning along with you, and it's real learning, and it's delivering stuff that is going to be a value creator for you and your organisations. And that's all I have to say.
Great, thank you very much. Don't go, we've got about 10 minutes of questions if anyone would like to ask any. I thought that was fascinating because two different angles on looking at transformational leadership between Craig and also Jace, and actually some of the same messages in terms of actually looking at the team and the way the leaders actually make sure that the team actually get to a high performing position. Okay, we've got a question there.
Yeah, thank you, Craig. Really fascinating stuff. Couple of points and questions mixed up, I think. Would be really fascinating to plot on your exponential of exponentials, if I can call it that, something that measures leadership. Because I think what you're actually saying is that we have currently got leadership in scarce supply, and the world that you've described is one which in leadership being distributed becomes boundless and becomes in abundance. So I think there's a really interesting curve to be drawn there. And then I was thinking beyond that, you haven't applied the same, certainly in this talk, you haven't applied the same principles of moving forwards to organisation. You've remained in the concept of an organisation being a single entity. And I think we've got to do precisely the same to organisation that we have done to leadership. And I wonder if Google becoming Alphabet is a step in that direction and taking them as your example.
Right. Good question. Thanks, David. So first question is actually starting to sound a bit like a thesis defence, isn't it? The first question, actually, I think we've probably got too much of leadership of the wrong sort. And we've certainly got a hell of a lot of leadership development, which has no effect. So.
Generation of new invention brought something extra which accelerated the exponential even more. And I'm suggesting that we're in the foothills of leadership in its current guise.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Your second question was about organisations. And yeah, I might have misled you on that because absolutely one of my points is that organisational forms are becoming totally different. It's incredible how much we're still sort of trapped by a sort of industrial model of organisation. No, there are clear, and hopefully I've given a couple of exceptions to that, where you know a couple of organisations like Uber, we just mentioned it, it's only a platform, and they don't actually do very much themselves, but they're incredibly successful by certain measures. So, yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's part of the issue, is we don't apply principles of transformation that I saw in city-states of 3,000 years ago to our own organisations, and that's the kind of challenge that we've got to be presenting ourselves, I think.
Okay. Any other questions at this stage? Come to you, sir.
Thank you, Craig. So who that we know of in the public eye embodies the leadership qualities that you've been describing?
That's a great question. It's almost like who would be my role model.
Exactly.
In the current public eye, in the UK, no one that I can think of off the top of my head. I think in other countries, there are. And it probably sort of flashed past you. I've been in India recently, and I happen to think that some of the best examples of transformational organisations, business models and leaders are in India. And you can, if you look closely at what's going on in India, there's some incredible value creation going on there. And what they're doing is, I mentioned a guy called Vinod Khosla, and in brief, he was one of the guys that flashed past. He's one of the founders of Sun Microsystems. And his thinking, his approach, his style is an example of the kind of thing that I think I'm talking about. So that would be where I'd probably start to take a look at. Not necessarily in the political domain, but certainly in the industrial domain.
Okay, got a question over here somewhere? No? Who else put their hand up? Oh, right. Oh, no. Oh, the just gentleman in the middle. I'll come over to you then.
Some comments and then a question for me. When you started off showing us the transformation that was occurring in Egypt and Athens, that was really, in my view, to use a genetic parallel, a hybrid vigour going on from the cultures joined together and the best emerging out of it. Do businesses that have perhaps got a bias towards plus 40s and a traditional structure need to get millennials into their organisation to generate the hybrid vigour from technology?
Yeah, they probably do, actually. And it's not just a technology thing, by the way. I mean, I'm at sort of pains to emphasise that this isn't just about tech companies, I don't think. But I think if you do, you've got to be really careful, because they're hell to manage. Because they think about the world in totally different ways that anybody over the age of 40 does. So they will be expecting, they have no respect for authority. They have a different attitude towards work. They actually are quite strongly values driven. And I think they pay attention to what the company is about and why it's doing what it's doing. They work in networks in a completely different way. So careful what you're taking on. But I do think that's the kind of stuff, there's the kind of material, the kind of talent that you need.
Than a regular employment.
So that if you heard the beginning of that, they prefer freelance rather than regular.
Yeah.
Yeah, and why would they do that?
It suits their lifestyle, apparently.
Totally, yeah. They you know, whereas, certainly I remember when I started work 30 years ago, you felt a strong commitment to the organisation you're working for. They're committed to their network. They may be committed to the sort of work they're doing. It'll be very unlikely they'll be committed to your organisation. So I think when you get realising that, then you can start to work with them in such a way that actually maps what you do with them against their value set. And I think there you've got some chance of succeeding with them.
Okay, I could talk about my 21-year-old son, given an added extra to that on his belief of how he needs to travel the world and how the world is a smaller place. So yeah, but I think we'll have one more question and then we'll wrap the session up and move on to our last session for this evening.
Thank you. We looked at your model and you gave some brilliant examples of tech and Uber, Google. I'm going to give you an example that you touched on as well with populism from the USA, where that model, and I'll give you an example of the companies, is called IT, IT, not intellectual technology, but IT Works. IT Works has grown exponentially. I don't like IT Works, because it's a pyramid selling scheme. It has an innovative product, but it isn't really innovative. It's all based on lies and mistrust and pulling on people's heartstrings that they can have the American way if they can save a little bit more and buy their product. And IT Works created an illusion called a wrap that is on Facebook, and they use technology, which is Facebook, as a platform to get and generate people to buy more of the product. And the wrap is just a bit of cling film with a bit of gel. And there's no science behind it. It's just smoke screen and mirrors. But this company's now just topped 5 billion, is looking to grow overseas, is targeting the UK market, it's going to target Europe and the Far East. And this sense of populism is the exact example of your model, where leadership is the yin and yang, the negative side of where this is misconstrued. Do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, sure. Thanks for the tip.
Just make sure you made a note of it and avoid it. I don't know, does anybody remember Enron from 2000? I was directly affected by Enron, actually, because my wife lost a job as a result of it. It's, I think there are probably some things about organisations that are eternally true, and you would, particularly from those that emerge from the US. If the organ, you can say something about leadership, you know, we can talk about very effective leaders who are fundamentally evil. So there are some fundamentals that don't change about business, and I'm not arguing that they should change. What I'm arguing is that if you're looking for a way of tapping into value creation and tapping into these exponential curves that I've been talking about, then there are certain things you're going to have to pay attention to. There are still bad organisations out there, and there probably always will be.
Okay, thank you very much, Craig. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Craig. Well, needless to say, what a pleasure it is to be here with you all today and to have you amongst us here. I was wondering, as you know, as JS presented, as Dr. Marsh presented, what's my claim to fame? And I'm not Chase. The closest I've got to Red Arrows is probably buying my tickets for the next air show. I'm not Dr. Marsh. I carry no PhD. I guess what I actually do have as my claim to fame, other than being from India and India having some of the very good entrepreneurial instincts that and case studies that hopefully subsequently we will bring a lot to platforms like this, is that I come from your part of the world. And I think what's most exciting for me to accept this role and really come in to work with LIBS and work on platforms like this is that I understand, and I've been through business for 22 years, like you are in businesses right now. So at Microsoft, I worked with a lot of organizations. I was the head of marketing and strategy. So my role was to work with businesses like yourselves to actually consult and work with them on growing their businesses from a marketing and business perspective. So I'm really delighted to be here in this role and to be able to connect with you going forward. I'm hoping that we can connect on a lot of things, and some of the conversations we had outside were brilliant around IT, Microsoft, the All Blacks, I worked with Scottish Rugby. So I think there are a lot of points that I'd like to find as common points where we could start conversations and take those forward as part of the business of LIBS. And I look forward to our engagement going, in the next few weeks and months. Okay. There are many moments in life, you know, when you hear some things, you look at some things and you say, right, that's what I'm going to learn from it. And there's something, some learning that you pick up from all of these moments. And one of them was a story of a shoe salesman that I came across, very interesting. So a salesman was sent to this remote part of the world and asked by his manager that, I've got to meet a number. You know what, why don't you go and sell shoes, because I have a revenue target to meet. We all have revenue targets to meet in our world. There was a telex sent back, and the salesman says, in those days the telex says, sorry, there's no market here, people do not wear shoes. The manager naturally, like a lot of us, was very frustrated. Well, I've got a number to meet, you've got to get me some sales. He called him back and he sent another person out there. And the other person sent this telex back in a couple of weeks. He says, there's a huge market here, people do not wear shoes. And the learning that I took out of this was, there's such a difference in attitude between the two people. And we heard about attitude and we heard about aptitude in the discussion that we had so far. The other thing that I came across, very simple in its format, but so brilliant in its message, was this slide, and that's it. So what do we see on this slide? And when I conduct this in my workshops, we see a black dot, so potentially yes. What we don't see, and in fact, this is about 4% of people don't see, is 4% of people see, and 96% see only the black dot. 4% of people don't see you is the white space around the black dot, which is the potential that exists, because the black space is taken, sorry. What exists for us to explore is the white space around it. And just simple things like this, when you come across in life, they really make you wonder that what makes a good employee? Who are we looking for? What makes a winning organization? And indeed, what kind of leader does it take to lead such an organization? And those are the questions you're probably asking yourself every minute in a business, and I've seen it myself through my 22 years of working as well. We are asking ourselves, what do I care about? Do I actually care about what I do or who I am? What kind of leader, what kind of person I am? And one of the topics that I very often like to engage in and I'd love to speak with you about is the power of a personal brand. the what kind of brands are we, what kind of brands are we creating within our organizations? And I'm sure we'll have many discussions and many opportunities going forward to really speak about that. Amongst the many, many definitions of leadership, I'd love to put one across, if you'll allow me a few seconds, which is a leader, someone you choose to follow because he or she can get you where you cannot go alone. Now, this is actually very deep to my mind because there's a choice, there's an element of choice. It's not by stature, it's not by title, it's not by the power that you're given by the organization. It's the choice people have to follow you. But the second aspect of this definition that I really care about is the aspect of rotational leadership. If somebody on my team can do something that makes me successful, to me, they are a leader. And I actually followed this in my work life. It works brilliantly. We could go on and on, but this is not the forum for me to do that. We could always open conversations about aspects like this to make your business successful, for you to develop leaders within your organizations that could make your organization successful. But I'm here today to actually talk to you about what we are going to do at LIBS. And at LIBS, we recognize, and from my experience, we recognize that we live in a VUCA world. And in case you haven't heard of this term, it's a brilliant management term that's doing the rounds today. And this talks about the volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity that your business world carries today. And I understand that world. There is so much change, there's so much complexity, and the changing business models as we just saw. In all of this VUCA, where do we find ourselves? How do we create centers of excellence in our business? And how can the business school, with its executive development center, really connect that for us, is what I'm here to talk to you about. Very briefly, but I wanted to give you an overview of the philosophy of how we want to create not managers, but leaders. And in the context of leadership, of course, there's a lot more that we can speak about. So I'd like to take the next 2 minutes just to speak to you about the philosophy with which I come into this role. I gave it a lot of thought, to be honest, while taking this up and saying, what is it that I can bring to this role so that it's useful for you and useful for the community in Lincolnshire and indeed beyond? And I think the philosophy that I want to approach this is by collaboration and by open thinking and by innovation, and not by any courses or programs which are listed which you can come and partake of, but more out of a boutique service where we come to you, we discuss, we collaborate, because each business's challenges or aspirations are different. They may work in the same industry, but they have different challenges and different aspirations, and I recognize that. And I think along with the team that's done a wonderful job so far, we wish to take that to the next one step to say, please connect with us, because the Executive Development Center is open, is flexible, and wants to create innovative solutions for you, not only in the area of leadership, which is on the table today, but indeed areas of excellence for your business, which could be many, as many as there are here. So we started a formal process of speaking with a lot of you that Emma's been keenly involved in, that I think I'd let Emma speak about, just to show you our approach and our philosophy. And what I'd like you to take away is that we intend to keep this philosophy alive with the Executive Development Center at LIBS to be able to reach out to you, hear you, collaborate with you, and really create solutions that are going to give you an impact for your business more than anything else.
So a couple of things happened. Three things happened about a year ago. Craig arrived at the business school. The business school became Lincoln International Business School. And we had a revised strategy, as Rishi observed just now, that we wanted to become a global network of learners. And first and foremost, we wanted to build that network in Lincolnshire. And the LLMC, which is easy to say now, I've been here 3 years, its original objectives were to support local businesses with the leadership and management skills within their organisations. When Craig arrived and when we built a new strategy, we needed to ramp that up and bring a new focus on. So we had to start by talking to you to find out what it is we could do, and what your perceptions were of us, and what we could do to help you with your leadership and management, but also help you to come into the university and do other things, to talk to our students, to meet our academics, to capitalise on the expertise here in Lincoln. So Jane and I went off on a road trip around Lincolnshire. We went north, south, east and west. We spoke to all types of businesses. We spoke to small businesses, micro businesses, large corporates, across all sectors, from manufacturing, food processing, high tech, local government, of course, who are key stakeholders of ours, and business support groups like the Chamber, the Institute of Directors, and the Federation of Small Business, so we could see how we could support all of you work together to achieve that, what we wanted to achieve. I want to thank those of you who were here tonight and who contributed to that, because it's your contributions that are basically what we're here for tonight. One of the contributions was that you wanted to network with one another, so we've already achieved that this evening by getting you together. We plan to do that more and more in the future. Okay, so some of the stuff we heard, very briefly, we heard an awful lot about what your challenges were in terms of leadership and management. And this, for me, I'm really pleased to see this kind of reflects what Jace was saying about the parts of your business challenge. We heard about how leadership and management was critical to the success of your business. It was critical to the performance of your people, getting the most out of each other. And it was critical to the future. What were you going to do when your current generation of leaders move on? What are you going to do next? And how we could help you in achieving, overcoming those challenges. This is just a word cloud, which is a bit tricky to read, but these are some of the things we heard you saying. So if as a business school, you're going to help us with that, we need you to offer us things which are accessible, which are ready now, which challenge our thinking, which are embedded in the real world, aren't a lecture in front of 200 students, are actually designed for us and our needs here in Lincolnshire. So what we've done is we have developed a number of things to help us do that so far, and we want to carry on that conversation with you. There's a whiteboard at the back. If you don't get a chance to talk to one of us, please write your comments and thoughts on there. We're going to be running more of these events. What do you want to hear about? What are the topics that are pressing for you at the moment that we can maybe provide some support with? In your pack here, our nice glossy black pack, you've also got information in there about some new programs that we've put together, again, in response to what you told us about needing leadership development across your entire organisation. We have three types of leadership program with dates that are taking place in the next few months, one for your senior leaders, your middle managers and your junior managers. We have a graduate program, which I'm really pleased we've developed actually with some of the businesses that are here tonight. We've sat down round table and designed a graduate program, which when you appoint graduates and have graduates in your business, we can help you build those business skills during those first few years with you. So hopefully you might attract more graduates, but B, they might stay longer and be able to contribute more in that time. The third thing in the pack is about our innovation programme, which is linked to the European funded programme the university has. We have a stand at the back from the people running that project who'd be happy to talk to you if you are a small to medium sized business in Lincolnshire, because there may be some funding available for you. So do please go and talk to them. So in terms of the business school's input there, we have a management program to develop your innovative skills within your businesses starting very soon. And last but not least, we have LIBS Connect, which we've launched tonight. We're really pleased to see over 100 people here, which is really exciting for us. Before we finish off tonight, Jane and Craig will show you the date of the next LIBS Connect event, which is taking place in the autumn, and we really hope to see you there.
I'd just like to take a minute to talk to you a little bit about the vision that we have for the Executive Development Center. On the one hand, the way I see it is there is you, your collective experience, and your businesses to run. On the other hand, we have the expertise that the business school and the university, in fact, at large, has to offer, plus the reach that we have into areas and experts beyond the boundaries of Lincolnshire, indeed beyond the boundaries of UK at times. If things go to plan and if you're able to discuss, start up a conversation which is useful, I see these two coming together on the same platform, which is through LIBS and through the Executive Education Centre. And that is where it really begins to become a reality, where we are pulling in the expertise we need to create innovative solutions for what you may need, such that you're able to take your business to what success means to you. But I will also, since I've got the opportunity of the stage here, offer to you that the Executive Development Centre is but one brilliant opportunity to connect with us. There are others. There is the work-based Centre for Learning, which we offer. There are students who are looking for employment through a career centre who you could benefit from, and there are schemes available for that as well. There is guest lecturing. You can actually utilise this platform as your own. And I think the way we see it is we want you to feel this is your space where you can come to for any sort of development that you want for your business and a vision that you have for your own success. We'd like you to really co-own this with us, and I think that's how we see the Executive Development Center going forward. So I really look forward to the, you know, to meeting with all of you once this closes very shortly, and indeed with our senior colleagues and academics and researchers who are here, and thank you to the colleagues who came in here today. Please do engage in a conversation, because there is plenty of academic opportunity to engage with us as well. So thank you so much, and I'll hand back to James. That's it for me.
Thank you very much. Thanks to Rushi and Emma. So some information for you there in terms of what's going to be on offer. We're very excited about this, because basically the offer, as you heard from Emma, has been built on going out and talking to businesses about what they want. In terms of this type of forum, our aim is to run the next one in October. It's actually going to be on developing teams. We've actually got a speaker who is a director of global operations from BP, and he's going to be talking about his experience in terms of building teams across the world and across all different levels. He started as an apprentice in BP, and he's now two off the main board. So he's got a very interesting story to tell from that point of view, and also from all the different organisations that BP connect with. We will have an academic speaker in the same way that we have tonight, be giving their viewpoint. And the whole point of these sessions together is really to give you some insights, get you a chance to network, and probably we would expect this to be smaller than tonight, because effectively we're sort of looking probably about 60 people who will come. It'll be more interactive than tonight, in the sense that we'll get you to do more work and sort of gain a lot out of the experience. So that will be in October. I have a feeling it's October the 14th. I know I ought to know the date. Oh, it's the 12th, it's on the board. Look at that, marvelous. I do like it when people back me up. That's what you call great teamwork. Okay, so there we are, 12th of October, and we will be going out with that in terms of letting you know a bit more information. Our aim is to run four of those a year. Okay, so they'll have a different topic each time, and again, I'm just going to repeat what Emma said. There is a whiteboard back in the other side of the curtain there. On it, you may write the topics that you find very valuable as businesses that you would like to be discussed. And we will try and get out and find ourselves some sort of industry speaker and some academic speaker who will come along and talk on that topic. So looking at doing those four times a year. Before we wrap up, several things, okay? This will take 2 minutes, so don't fret. First of all, we've got a draw for a bottle of champagne and some chocolate. Some lucky people there. I wish I put my card in there, actually. Jazz, would you like to actually tell us who that is? Okay, this is Jack Green. Do we have a Jack Green? Oh, excellent. Well done. Okay, Jack, you can't leave without buying some consultancy from us. Okay. That's in return. Well done. Well done. That's absolutely excellent. Okay, in terms of wrap-up, I think we've had a very interesting evening in terms of looking at transformational leadership. I started by kicking the ball off with looking at the election. I somehow feel that although Jeremy Corbyn was perhaps the most transformational leader out of the people who were there, some of the principles and requirements for that transformational leadership to work, as put over by Jace and Craig, rather are missing in terms of Jeremy Corbyn's record so far in the Labour Party. So maybe that doesn't work all the way through. Maybe it's just one of those things of the moment in time in terms of him giving the vision part, but not the rest that goes with it. I think leadership is a particular passion of mine as well, actually. If you look at the journey of it, you have, you know, you'll all be there, styles of leader, characteristics of leader. They're all there, that there is the holy grail that all of you can go out and actually suddenly hit all these bullet points and you will make the grade. And I think both, again, Jace's and Craig's presentation showed you that actually that's probably not the case. And it is something to do with the way you react to your external environment and the way you bring your teams along with you. And the same in terms of Rishi's debate there at the end, in terms of it's all about the values and also about who will follow you. So leave you with that point. Please have a great networking session now. Drinks and canapes the other side of the curtain. Thank you for your attendance and your patience.
Thanks, Sharon. I'd just like to finish off by thanking the team who put this event together, because it doesn't come together all by itself. And some people here worked extremely hard for it, so I'd just like to acknowledge them. Ed, Chris, Caroline, where are you? Cheryl, I'd just like to stand up. Emma, and Jane, of course, and Rushi. So thank you all for the work effort you put into this. Brilliant, guys.